of people seem to believe that although the market economy is a swell system, it requires the equivalent of a Soviet commissar to be in charge of money and interest rates. This belief is altogether misplaced. The Federal Reserve System, or simply the Fed, is both harmful and unnecessary. Since the Fed's creation in 1913, the dollar has lost at least 95% of its value. If the much maligned gold standard had produced such a result, we'd never hear the end of it. But in our system, the Fed is, for whatever reason, curiously exempt from criticism. Under the Fed, therefore, people have lost an option they once had, namely accumulating savings in cash. Under a commodity standard, people could save for the future simply by accumulating precious metal coins, which back when they functioned as money, held or even increased their value. No one has that option any longer. In other words, only a fool would try to save by piling up dollar bills. Instead, everyone is forced to become a speculator and to invest in securities markets they know little about and that can wipe them out entirely if times turn bad. As early as the 18th century, Richard Cantillon identified distribution effects as another way inflation harms the general public. The newly created money is injected at particular points. Whoever receives it first, in other words, people who happen to be politically well-connected, get to spend it before prices have commensurately risen, and they thereby enjoy a windfall. By the time it trickles down to the general public, those people have been paying the higher prices to which the new money gives rise all that time. Private and public debt have exploded under this system, especially since the collapse of Bretton Woods in 1971. No one has a right to be surprised when indebtedness skyrockets under a system in which credit can be created out of thin air. The very existence of the Fed, a central bank, institutionalizes the problem of moral hazard. Moral hazard involves an actor's willingness to behave with an artificially elevated level of risk because he believes any losses he may incur will be borne by someone else. Since there is no physical limitation on paper money creation, market actors know the paper money producer can bail them out if things go terribly wrong. They have been vindicated in this belief time and again. They will, therefore, be more reckless in their investment activity and speculation than would otherwise be the case. We were once told that boom-bust business cycles were a thing of the past because, thanks to the Fed, we now have scientific management of the money supply. If anyone believes that today, I'd like to meet him. Artificially low interest rates, courtesy of the Fed, do not in fact yield us a utopia of sunshine and kittens. To the contrary, they artificially stimulate capital goods production and long-term investment. They thereby deform the structure of production into a configuration that the public's freely expressed pattern of saving and consumption will not be able to sustain. When this phony boom inevitably collapses, it is capitalism that is stupidly blamed, when in fact the Fed, a non-market institution, is the culprit. I'm interested in neither the saccharine promises nor the technical details of the alleged superiority of a monopoly fiat money system. The Fed is the lifeblood of the empire, the great enabler of the perversion of the original American Republic into the world's largest and most powerful government. Even if the Fed did confer a net economic benefit, a contention the great Austrian economists F.A. Hayek and Ludwig von Mises strenuously denied, in fact, Hayek won the Nobel Prize in the process of denying it, even if the Fed did confer a net economic benefit, the alleged benefit could not possibly be worth the destruction of the American soul. As it turns out, we don't have to make that choice. When it comes to the Fed, justice, economic prosperity, and the values of the original American Republic are joined together. The Fed, its academic apologists, and the drones in our supposedly free press who demonize all dissent from the monetary status quo have done our economy enough damage. For the sake of American freedom and prosperity, it is long past time that, in the spirit of Andrew Jackson, we killed the monster.